everyone. Welcome to Film Independent Presents Live Edition Virtual. Before we get started with today's very exciting conversation, I just have to thank some of our partners, the Hollywood Foreign Press Association. Thank you very, very much for all of your support these years, and our platform Vision Media. If you are watching live today, we ask you to please ask some questions at the end of this. There's a little Q&A box at the bottom, and our lovely moderator, Carla, will ask our panelists at the end. Without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Carla. It was lovely to meet you all, and thank you so much for supporting Film Independent.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
All right, y'all, let's get this pink party started. I am in my pink to be part of the pink posse for today's moderating conversation. Yes, I need some snaps and claps for that. As Rachel said, I am your moderator, Carla Renata, aka the Curvy Film Critic. And I'm just going to go around as I see people on the screen and introduce them, and then we'll get into the conversation. First up, we have my girl, Brandy Evans, aka Mercedes, in the house, honey. We have Geeta Patel, who directed episode 5. She's in the house. We have the creator and the head woman in charge of the pink posse, Miss Katori Hall.
You the HBIC.
Yes, I didn't want to go there, but I'm glad you went there instead. Next up, we have Nico Anan. Is that how you pronounce your last name?
Nico Anan.
Anan. Nico Anan, Uncle Clifford himself, baby. Ow! Sampling crap. And last but not least, okay, now please forgive me. Ellerica Johnson.
Yes!
Ellerica Johnson, aka Hallie, aka her other character. Thank you all for.
Lakeisha Savage. She got some.
She is Savage, honey. Ella, AKA Autumn. So thank you all for joining us for this Film Independent conversation. I'm going to get into it and try to ask as many questions as fast and furious as I can, because the question and answer box is filling up very quickly. And I want to make sure that we get to everyone's questions if we can. I'm going to start with the HBIC. Miss Katori Hall, I want to know, what was the impetus to make you take this from a play to bring it to the small screen instead of the big screen? Because it could have been a feature film instead of bringing it to television as a series.
Absolutely. It's interesting. So I have been researching the play version for 6 years. Like, I had done dance workshops. It was just full. It was so dense. It was full of life. It was full of plot and all these amazing characters that we get to know and love. And so when I saw it on that damn stage, I was like, oh, child, this is a television show. This ain't no play. This ain't no film. You need years. You need years to go into just all of it. The world was just, you know, of strip clubs. It's spectacular. You know, there's the athleticism, but it's also just like, you know, the lives and the fact that I was going to be able to focus on women who we had never really seen in a very humanized way. Like, we've seen, you know, shows that got strippers, but they're always kind of like the background. But for me, they're at the foreground. They're on that pedestal, which is that stage. And so I was like, no, I got to turn this into a TV show. And so thank God Stars was like, okay, come here, girl. Come here, girl. That's a good idea.
And here I love it. I love everything about it. And you know who I love, who is not here with us today, who is my Howard Bison sister, is Miss Harriet D. Foy. Miss Patrice, I got to give her a shout out. I got to. We Bisons, right. We grew up in the thing together, so I got to give her a shout out. But thank you for sharing that, Katori, because that was the first thing I wanted to know. I'm like, how did this happen? And you're right, we have seen other stories like this before. We've seen Hustlers, we've seen Striptease, we've seen so many others, but this one delves a little bit deeper and further into the heart and the soul of the women beyond their pumps and their very sparkly, beautiful outfits. Geeta, to direct a show like this, and this is what I also love. So Katori, thank you for bringing so many women, especially women of color,
to the show to direct and or write these episodes. I have to give you your snaps and claps for that. Thank you, thank you, thank you. With Geeta being one of them. Geeta, what was it like for you to direct, excuse me, this type of show? Because it's not your ordinary run-of-the-mill TV show. It really isn't.
It was really inspiring more than anything. Katori's words are palpable. I had never worked with writing like that before. It was so grounded and so real. And so I felt like it was a challenge to me as a director to maintain that. And, you know, working with the actors, they also all are just spectacular. They're so grounded, so willing to challenge themselves and constantly working harder and harder. And so I think it was quite humbling as a director to feel like I needed to actually just support what was already working and build around it so we could have this very, very real world. And coming from India, coming from the villages there, I felt, even though I'm not from the same background as the world in the show, I had a certain, I think, relationship with that realism, that feeling of, you know, we're all a village, we're a community, we understand each other. And there's this primal animalistic way that we see the world, and that's beautiful. And honestly, it was the performances and the writing.
Let's talk about that, because your particular episode took place, a good chunk of it, in that jail cell with all those women in that jail cell. How challenging was that to decide who to do a close-up on, when to separate them? That looked like it was very challenging to shoot, and I just wanted to get your thoughts on that. It may not have been, but it looked like it was a bear.
It was really hard, right, Katori? It was a hard one.
To the point where, you know, we had, oftentimes you don't rehearse until you that we were going to rehearse, you know, I think it was either the weekend before, some days before we were going to enter our jail set. And thank God that we were able to do that, because, you know, I think you had three cameras that you had to roll.
Yeah, we had three cameras and we had singing. And one of the things that we embraced that I had a really like educational time with, honestly, I had never done things this way before. And that's what I love about the way you work, Katori, is I just felt like we're all so inspired to just do what we need to do to get the job done, as opposed to like do what's supposed to be done, you know? And with that particular section, we had live singing, and we thought, well, why are we going to do this in a theatrical setting? Let's embrace the singing. Like, let's do a live track. Let's just let people overlap. Usually when you're directing, you isolate the singing from everything else and you do different tracks. We didn't do that. We just let it go. Like, it was a live performance, and we were all nervous, and it was exciting. And that's actually, I would say 80% of what made the cut was from that version of filming that scene. So I think we just leaned into it.
Real. Yeah.
Can we give a shout out to the actress, that the full figured curvy actress that we thought was tone deaf, and then in that jail cell we found out that she could blow. Can we just give her some snaps and claps? Because when she busted out, I was like, oh, but she can sing. Not sing, but sing. Okay,
give it up for Dana. That's Dana.
Dana, what's her last name?
Gurrier.
Yep. Dana Gurrier. Girl, if you were watching this at some point, you did your thing, and I was there for every last second of it. It was fabulous. It really was. Now, Katori, I read an article where you referred to the language in which you speak to the dolls on the show about their routines as slanguage. And I want you to explain to me what that means before we get to the dolls and the dude about their performances.
Absolutely. So slanguage is this beautiful fusion of slang, accent, and dialect. I love how Black folk talk. I feel like when we speak to each other, we making love, we making music. We are so just majestic. And the fact that our communicative style of just being with each other, it is so musical. I really wanted to capture all of that. And so that's actually a hallmark of my work, period. Like in every Katori Hall play or, you know, movie, you know, in the next TV shows that are coming very soon, you have that slanguage. And so I was just so honored that Starz was like, okay, we're just going to let you be, because there had been a conversation about like, oh, should we subtitle this? And I was like, no. These people are speaking English. So, you know, it's just English, the blackety black way. And that's okay. It's a valid communication.
I love that. I love the way that you write. It's so indicative of the way we speak. Because oftentimes when you watch us on television, us meaning anybody of any ethnicity, we don't necessarily see people speaking the way we actually talk in real life. So it was very refreshing. And I was there again. I was just there for everything. So you're going to hear me say that over and over again, because I just kind of was. Nico, Uncle Clifford, honey.
Yes, Carla. Yeah.
honey. I need to know what would be Uncle Clifford's rules for 2021?
Ooh. You know what's so funny, what just came to me, is you got to get to where the money resides. 7-Eleven, 7-4-11, get to where the money resides, baby. But yeah, I'm just gonna leave it there. There's so many rules, but those rules are like ways of life to keep you on the right track and the right path. It's I call them like Katori's biblical. Those are her commandments.
Okay, I can get with that. Katori's commandments. I kind of love that. You need to adopt that, girl. That's a good one. And also, Nico, I wanted to talk to you about your look and your feel of Uncle Clifford, because most of the time, or a lot of the time, when we see characters like this on the small and the big screen, they usually make a choice to look completely feminine and not masculine at all. They may behave a little masculine and feminine, but they don't have the facial hair. You can't visibly see sometimes that they are masculine. And I wanted to know how much input you had into Uncle Clifford's look, how he dressed, how he spoke, what he wore, his makeup.
This is a multi-layered answer and question.
Go ahead, answer it.
well, Carla, look, I ain't scared, nah. I know you're not.
I wasn't scared to ask you either.
I mean, it's a lot to it, because first of all, I had the pleasure and the honor of originating the character when it was on the stage, when Katori wrote this back in 2009, when we first started with those pages. And then we had a full production in 2015 at Mixed Blood Theater. And it was in that live performance that there's been so much that has been revealed to me as the actor about Uncle Clifford. And one of those was literally about the facial hair. Because we were talking about like, oh, so it came time getting close to costumes and wardrobe and stuff. And the director at the time was basically, she said, okay, so Nico, you know, we need you to shave and we want to go get your nails done. And I was like, go get my nails done. What we doing? You know? And, you know, they were going to send me, I was going to go to the salon to get my nails done. And it was in that space that the conversation really started to come about as an actor, I was in a space that was not home. I wasn't familiar with the surroundings and what that would be like for my safety to be able to go around every day off the stage, still in full character, and what that meant. I understood in that moment the gravitas of it, the weight, and the importance. We also had conversations in that time about shaving and the difference between drag and non-binary, the non-binary space. And Uncle Clifford is not a drag queen. She uses she and her pronouns. She is non-binary, or as some people say, gender fluid. Mm-hmm. You know, the notion of the idea, I asked Katori some years ago, where did this come from? And she just said to me, she said, what could it be like if a person accepted all of their femininity and all of their masculinity? So therein lied an oasis of just vision and dreams that I was not restricted to anything. I knew that we were in the South. I know this is gutta as well as glittery. So I knew that there had to be something that if Uncle Clifford was at the door with Diamond and people were coming in, patrons were coming in, this isn't necessarily a gay club. This is a club where these women and people live, right? All of these marginalized communities. So Uncle Clifford literally standing at the door, holding space for those people. There had to be the welcome, but also the sergeant. And I just thought that at the time, the facial hair was just a part of it. And it became the design of it comes from some backstory. You know, you see it a little bit of that in the first episode, and the rest of it, you know, you'll get in season 2, 3, 4, 5.
That's right. Y'all got picked up for season 2. So congratulations on that. Congratulations to all of you on that. All right. And last but not least, let me get to the two ladies. Y'all, you know, I got to ask it because let me share something that is FYI, but not really. So I was in a relationship where I decided that I wanted to spice things up a little bit. And there's a place not far from where I live in the Valley that teaches pole dancing that was highlighted on the Oprah Winfrey show. I went and I kept slamming myself into the pole, because every time I would go to swing, I would slam right into the pole. So, and just was black and blue, and it was a hot buttered mess. But having said that, when you all were training for these roles, did you have a moment like that where you were swinging around or you were doing them death drops? Because there's that one scene, Miss Brandy, where you doing that death drop, and I was like this. I was like, oh Lord, you know. So can we just start with that for a second, and I'll start with Brandy first.
It is very difficult. Standing ovation to the ladies that do this as a profession, or as competition. The pole work is not a game. So yes, I know Ella and I have had many moments of sharing bruises. Me, Ella, Shannon, and Skylar, just sharing our bruises. But we embrace them because it's authentic to the world. And, you know, sometimes you got to callus it up to get on up that pole. And, you know, once it get hard and then you all right, you can climb the pole. But it was very difficult, but very, very rewarding. I think we all really felt proud of ourselves and we were able to get the stunts that we were able to accomplish on our own to go, yeah, we did that. Like, we feel really proud. So very difficult, and standing ovation to these ladies because it is a sport.
Ella, how long did you all have to work on the routine in terms of choreographing it, getting it down to where you were comfortable performing it on screen?
Well, to be honest, I was quite lucky because Autumn is learning. So I learned with her. So I didn't have to be fancy from the beginning, which is great, because I struggled, because it is, I second exactly what Brandy said, it's so hard. But we were training. We trained in our hometowns before we went to Atlanta, and then we had training there. And, you know, I have to kind of give it up to Brandy on this one, but she was just working her butt off. And that same thing, what you're talking about, where she slid down, well, your hands were up here, mine were down here, because I honestly, she was incredible. The girls we had were amazing. And yeah, stripping is, well, pole dancing, sorry, in general, is just an absolute art form. It's incredible what they do.
I'm going to get to these questions because there's like a zillion of them. And I really want to make sure that everybody gets their questions answered. The first one is, well, the first comment, I should say, Yusef says he binged the whole thing in a day and it's so good. So I wanted to make sure that y'all knew he said that.
Roller coaster ride, child. You all
right? Right. In one day.
I'm sure he is just fine. Katori, Kelly AB3 wants to know, how long did it take you to, oh, we already answered that question. Never mind. We answered that question. Let's go to another one. Let's see here. Oh, Ella, what drew you to the role of Haley, and how are you like the character, and how are you different?
Man, the writing, Katori, she's incredible. You are incredible, Katori. The writing was amazing. And I remember getting the script and just being engrossed. And page 4, I called my agent and was like, I really want this one. And he's like, okay, we'll take our time, because we don't get too excited because you never know what happens. And yeah, I just feel very blessed that, you know, that everyone thought I was right for the role. But she's an incredible character. And for me, that's what I always look for, is someone who's complex and someone who's going to scare me. Like, she scared the hell out of me because I'm like, damn, I really got to work. Like, I really got to do my best here. She's amazing. But like, very similar in some ways. You know, there's lots of trials and tribulations that we have to go through as women and as people in general. And, you know, I really relate to to those things. And then also, you know, her being a bit of a prude at the beginning with her dancing and stuff, that's definitely me. But a couple of glasses of wine and I'll be on the stage. So there's similarities there.
You needed that liquid courage, huh, girl?
Just a little bit.
Brandy, would you mind addressing that same question and then we'll go to Nico after you're done?
Yes, sure. Mercedes and I, it's almost scary at times. I tell Nico sometimes, I'm like, sometimes I feel like Mercedes is me at times. I'm a PK in real life. I'm also, and PK is a preacher's kid, if y'all don't know. So I'm from Memphis. So that Southern feel just felt so amazing. And that's the biggest thing that drew me to the role. It felt like home when I first read the script. I had a toxic relationship with my mom growing up. I'm really a dance coach in real life. And I have a company that teaches women how to be confident and sexy. So that teacher in me, that Mercedes you see is, you know, always trying to tell someone how to do something and do that. I have a little problem with that at times.
I would never know it. Girl, you are an actress for the gods, because I would never know it.
Yes, for the gods, for the gods.
He's an emotional gangster, and I can definitely say that I'm an emotional gangster as well.
So, yeah. I love that. Nico, would you mind addressing that same question as well?
I say I am similar to Uncle Clifford in nurturing, in the nurturing quality and like love. And I think that we both are similar in a space of being able to use dance and the body as means of communication beyond just words. So that's the short answer.
And let me just address the love story that Uncle Clifford had within the series. It was very tastefully done. It was beautifully done. And I loved that. And I loved how you handled it. And I loved how Katori wrote it. And I loved how Gita directed it. So thank all of you for that. It was absolutely fantabulous. It really, really was. Speaking of which, Gita, there is a lot of love for you in this Q&A. Folk are like, why did you direct just one episode and are you directing some more?
Yes, Gita.
Come on, Gita. Because I ain't seen you in a long time. I need you, Gita.
Well,
you know, it's so funny.
Everybody is giving you that eye, Gita.
You know, it's so funny. I have to be honest. Like, when you come in to direct these kinds of things, I mean, y'all know, like, when you're guesting as an actor, you know, you go in and you're so terrified to mess up. And you're so terrified to be like, I'm always terrified to be the worst director the show's ever had. And I remember during the shooting, you know, just being so nervous. I always am, because you just feel like there's such a responsibility put on you when everyone is so talented and everything is so good. It's like yours to mess up, you know? And so I really appreciate that. But I think as far as one episode, for those of you watching that, or maybe, you know, wondering how that all works. I don't get it either. Like ideally you would have maybe two directors taking turns, but in the culture of television for years and years, like decades, it's always been, actually now it's getting more simplified, but since I can remember and my ancestors can remember, like it's always been, you have many directors, and a lot of it has to do with the efficiency, because as someone's directing, someone else is prepping. So, you know, that's usually how it works. I also think, and Katori can speak to this, but first season, sometimes you want to try out different directors and see how they work and who you dive with and stuff like that. So that's another component of it. For me, working as a guest director doing one episode, I think what's interesting is I don't know if everyone works this way, but I watched all the footage I could of everything that was shot before my episode. I studied each actor in that footage and tried to understand how each of them worked, because basically you're sliding in and taking over for, you know, you're like someone's hand coming in one episode and then you're out, but you have to make sure that episode doesn't like stick out like a sore thumb. It's got to, you know, be fluid like everything else. It has to be of the same verse. So yeah. It was quite exciting. I miss it, looking at all of you on this call.
We love Gita so much, and she pretty much had, I think, the hardest episode. Yeah. Like, it's such a huge turning point for so many of the characters, and so her ability to honor this Delta Noir visual aesthetic with comedic elements, with all this gravitas. I learned a lot about my work, and I learned how to be a better artist and a better writer working with Ethan. And, you know, it's going to happen again. She going to come back. But, you know.
We're going to figure something out.
Yeah, we already talking.
Because seriously, they're like, we need for her to come back. So I just want to make sure y'all knew that. Katori, let's talk about the mother-daughter relationship and the way it's addressed in the series. Because it is like a staple and a crutch of the show. It's one of the things that makes you want to come back and watch it again and again and again, because there's like this love-hate situation going on. She loves her because she feels like she has to, because that's her mother. But at the same time, she hates what she does. I don't think she hates Patrice as a person. She just hates what she does and what she stands for, and that she uses the Bible and the words in the Bible to manipulate.
Yeah, I just think it's something that Black folks know real well. Like that, and particularly Southern Black folks, just this thing like you can't do nothing to your mama. Like you can't raise a hand to your mama. That's what the elders say in the jail cell.
Yes.
Everyone wanted to kill Patrice Woodbine because the things that she does, like taking advantage, manipulating, shaming her. But of course, it's under, you know, religion and the fact that, you know, in the South, there still is this kind of battle between the secular and the sanctified, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we really delve into how, like, a lot of people can be hypocritical. And it, you ain't even really just got to be in the church. It'd be, you know, all kinds of folks be hypocritical and saying that you shouldn't be doing that. Why are you taking off your clothes knowing that they sleep with all kinds of folks and somebody else, you know, daddy at the same time? Mm-hmm. But, you know,
that part, right?
So for me to be able to show an honest, articulation of a relationship that's dysfunctional between a mother and a daughter was just so important, because that shit is real.
It really is.
We have a lot of shame surrounding, you know, talking about our dirty laundry. But you know, I really think it was some panties that needed to be put on the line so that I could get a little free and really address some toxic stuff that oftentimes can happen. Not only within Black families, but all families.
Yeah. The panties needed to be aired out, huh?
That is
hilarious. I want to go back to Ella for a minute. There's the moment at the auction moment was so incredibly powerful to me, because instead of her wearing black, trying to blend in, she's got on all white from head to toe. And oftentimes Autumn does wear white in this show all the time, white t-shirt, white strip outfit, everything is always in white to I guess illustrate the fact that she is on the good side of the law as opposed to the bad side of the law, even though she's done some bad things, right? But that moment at the auction was so incredibly powerful, because somebody, and I can't remember what character said it, says you make your own luck. Someone says you make your own luck. But this is the thing that I want to talk to Autumn about more than anything else, and this is a question from my mama. My mama wants to know, Ella, why did Autumn ever go back to Texas, and why did she get off the bus in Mississippi and get off the bus in Mississippi in the first place? She said, "Don't you know that that's a slave state and it's very racist? Why were you getting off the bus in Mississippi?" That's what my mama want to know. Oh, I'm gonna play this back for her so that she can see it. So.
It's a good question. Though it was always that Autumn was just gonna pick somewhere. It was wherever, you know, wherever just felt right. I think at that time I don't think she wanted, she didn't know what she wanted to do. She just know that she was going to give herself another chance, and where was going to be the best place for this new chance. And the bus stopped, and she got out, and she had a cigarette, and there's the lights, and there's the bus. This is just where it's going to be. I don't think she thought about where it was exactly. She was just like, this is just a quiet little old town where I can, you know, hide out and get myself together and maybe see if I can make this work. And it just felt like the perfect place.
You know, some things are indicative to the Black community, like Katori said, the church, the barbershop, and people talking through stuff when you're trying to watch it. And my mama talks through everything. So the whole time we watching it, because we watched it together. Why does she do this? And why does she do that? And what's going on with Uncle Clifford? I'm like, Ma, really? I need to watch this because I got questions to ask. Speaking of which, the season follows so many changing characters, attitudes, loyalties, conflicts, etc. We always feel attuned and grounded to each character's emotional moment in each scene. Katori, how do you make sure the audience isn't getting ahead of you? And how do you make sure it's clear to them exactly what's going on?
Interesting. I often think of my audience as extremely, extremely smart. And so I am often accused of being too vague, but I'm like, Black people smart, they'll get it. And if they don't know the answer to that question, it's gonna be answered later. And real talk, it's good to have questions as you are watching something. Mm-hmm. The really great thing about season one is that every question got an answer by episode 8. Because I know everybody's like, where's Oliver from? And who she running from? And where she getting all this money? And then Montavious show up.
Questions
are answered.
Not the click. Not the mouth click. I cannot. Oh, y'all yes. are funny down. For all of you all, and I'll start with Brandy going around, what are some of your stylistic influences for taking on Mercedes?
Stylistic, wow. You know what, I've never really thought of it like that. I just truly live in the moment of her. And you don't really have to think too hard with Katori's writing. It's right there for you. Like Nico has said, what she writes is what it is. And for me, I just tried to tap into the authenticity of it, of what I felt before. So I've never really, like, some people like, oh, I think of this artist or this and that. I never did that with Mercedes. I never had a celebrity thought of that's who Mercedes was. Mercedes was authentically grown and growing with each episode.
And Nico, can you answer that same question? Stylistic influences for Uncle Clifford?
Style, I too didn't use a person. Aside from actually Kevin Aviance would be one of them who had, you know who Kevin Aviance is? Dum da da dum do do dum da da dum do. That's his song. but aside from that, I would say more so spirit animals, so butterflies and eagles. Were the images that I thought of spirit animals for Uncle Clifford. Butterflies, because of the transformation and the elegance of them. Both butterflies and eagles have flight. And with the eagle, I was thinking about the hunter and protector and vision, being able to see everything and all things, being above, and eagle claws, like the nails coming in, swooping and getting all of that. I think that's where some of the gestures come from the eagle mindset.
I actually could see that. Now that you say that, I can actually see that. Good on you. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now I got to see it again just to peep that. Before we get to you, Ella.
You know, we some artists up in here, Carla. You know, we some artists.
Clearly, y'all are. before I get to Ella, Clifford, see, I'm calling you by a character name. Nico and Katori. The audience loves the relationship between Uncle Clifford and Loretta Devine's character. Are we going to get to see more of them in season two?
Absolutely. Yes, it was a dream to bring Loretta Devine into the Pink family fold. Shout out to Tasha Smith, who had her phone number. And I was like, I'm going to the line. And she's like, I got you.
I got her phone number. Hold on. Let me get on the line.
And literally within a few days, Loretta Devine was standing in front of us. And so I got Tasha and her Rolodex and her cell phone numbers.
Yeah, for sure.
That is hilarious. The audience would also like to know, were there any episodes inspired by any real life events? And how did your own experiences influence your performances? We'll start with Ella with that one.
Oh, you know, every time I kind of speak about Autumn, I just remember the time that I worked on her. It was a lot of kind of digging deep, just because of, you know, all the kind of heartache that she comes from and kind of living in the darkness almost, but trying to still be the light on the outside. And so I would always look to moments that I spend with other people in my life, with other women who were dealing with certain things and going through certain stuff, and moments where I sat down with them and we cried and we laughed and we dug really deep and we were honest and open and just, yeah, I think it was just living in those moments really.
Mm. And your stylistic influences for playing Haley?
Again, I don't particularly think there was one. There was this, you know, conversation about her being a chameleon because of all of the changes that she had, you know, all of these disguises. She had to change in order to suit her environment, in order to blend in so that, you know, people wouldn't find her in this place and people wouldn't, you know, she almost had to kind of just sit in the background as well. So with the wigs, it was the changing, the constant, you know, different outfits, like with Mercedes as well, going to get the money and stuff, all of those moments. So yeah, I think there was a little bit of that kind of animal feel, the reptile, should I say, like Uncle Clifford with his feathers, which I might say, I remember having a conversation with him just about the birds. And honestly, if you're ever looking for some inspiration or some beautiful words on a day,
it's Nico.
Honey. Oh man, amazing. Yeah.
I love that. I want to ask y'all a question, and I'll go around the screen as opposed to the room. I read an article that Brandy did for Elle magazine, and in it she quoted Meryl Streep, and she said that Meryl Streep said in an award show, "Take your broken heart and make it into art." And I feel like that is the best way to describe what P-Valley is for someone who's never seen it. Would you agree or disagree? I know Brandy agrees because Brandy quoted it, but how about Geeta, Katori, Nico, and Ella? I'll start with Geeta first.
Oh gosh. Yeah, I think every single character in this story is an underdog, someone who doesn't feel accepted, doesn't feel like they belong. I can't think of a single person in my life who doesn't feel that way, hasn't come from that background, actually. I think that's what unifies the audience for this, that it's the audience isn't just people of a certain background. The audience is universal because we all feel that way. We all obviously want to be important, belong, be enough. So, yeah.
Okay, Katori.
Interesting, you know, I spent 6 years going all around America interviewing women and going to these clubs and sitting in those locker rooms and going home with them and meeting husbands and mothers and sons and daughters. And so I got well acquainted with their dreams and their nightmares. And so I felt so blessed that they trusted me to spill so many secrets in my ear. And I remember there was this moment when I was with one of the dancers at home, and she had put like a pole in her living room, and she was like teaching some other actresses, you know, how to do these amazing moves. And I was just like, I just promised her, even though I didn't say it out loud, that I was going to show her with love, respect, and honor her struggle, but most importantly, honor her life, her heart, her dreams. And so while there is a kind of brokenness that I think every human being deals with, I do think women, and particularly women of color, deal with a different kind of brokenness. Sometimes it can break you. But the fact that these women continue to be resilient, they're so inspiring, and they inspired me. And that's why I wanted to do this show. It took me 10 years to get this show on.
Wow.
And yeah, like from you know, the idea to the play version to developing it for TV, you know, and it almost didn't make it, y'all. And wow. Yet I'm here today, and it has hit millions of people straight in the heart, straight in the gut. And it has, in a weird way, nothing to do with me, but everything to do with these women who inspired me and kind of tattooed themselves on my
But body. It does have to do with you, because it has to do with your resilience.
Yeah, so
let's just
resilient, because they asses was resilient. So.
Okay, well, let's just call a spade all the way around.
Hey,
Nico, your broken heart into art.
I always think this gift and this duty as an actor and an artist in general is all about turning your trash into treasure. You know, like that is the thing that, you know, and I come from a people that know how to make shit shine. You know what I mean? And from language, like Katori was talking about earlier, to dance, the way we, you know, to the way we cook, you know, like different cuisines, especially in the South, they came from scraps, you know, but now we worldwide, people are calling them delicacies, you know, and gourmet. I just feel like, you know, that's a superpower that we all have as artists, whether you are a dancer, director, writer, actor, painter, musician, you get to take feelings and you can give voice that think that people don't always have. They don't always have the access or ability to do. So that's how I kind of look at it.
Cool. And last but not least, Ella.
I'll say it's the vulnerability in that. That's such a good line, Brandy, to quote, because you have to just let it all go. So, you know, that's one thing. I think that's the hardest thing and sometimes, you know, difficult when you're on set to just really remove everything and be at the core of it and just say, hey, this is me. This is what I'm giving to this character. This is what I'm giving to this script. And this in turn is what I'm giving to everybody in order to experience this world and this life and have them take meaning from that. So being vulnerable, being open and honest, that's all we can be really. And I think, yeah, I think it's pretty cool that we get to do that.
Cool. I know y'all can't spoil it for season two, but what is your wish list for your characters for season two, Brandy?
Notes, because we working right now for my pen.
He's like, where it at? I'm gonna write it down. Other than Gita coming to direct, what's the wish list for you, Brandy?
Yes, I need Gita back. Thank you. But I really want Mercedes and Terica to get together. I want that so badly for her. Depending on who it is, Katori, let's talk. Mercedes can have a man. Season one. So
we're going to leave that there. We're going to move on to Ella because you're about to go somewhere else. Go on, girl. Come on, Ella. What's your wish list for Haley?
I think let's get Haley a new car, man. just reversing that car, that took nearly half a day. I don't want to have to do it again. Let's get in the car, please.
And Nico for Uncle Clifford.
Hilarious. My wish list would be seeing some of just more of Uncle Clifford's like life outside of the club, seeing her friends and like her circle outside of the dancers and how that all came to be, and to, you know, find love.
Yes. See, we need some love.
I think Haley's had enough of that, so let's just...
There you go.
I'm going to have one. Sorry.
See, because Haley is where the money resides. Haley is where the money resides.
Haley is where the money resides. I think that is a great way to stop this conversation, because, honey, we could go all day and all night, but I ain't trying to have y'all looking at your ring light all day and all night. But on behalf of Film Independent, I am your moderator, Carla Renata, AKA the Curvy Film Critic. I would love to thank Ms. Brandy Evans, AKA Mercedes, director Gita Patel, Nico Anand, AKA Uncle Clifford, Ella Johnson, AKA Haley, AKA Autumn. Thank all of you and the HBIC of P Valley, baby, Miss Katori Hall. Thank you so much for taking your time to speak to us today and to do this wonderful Q&A. For everybody watching and listening, thank you so much for tuning in, and we will see y'all the next time. Bye.